Thank you, Elizabeth. My name is Jim. I am an alcoholic. Everybody.
Don't touch the mic.
You know, we have a lady in the Stairway group. She's our treasurer. And every time she does the chips, she gets mixed up on the white chips. I keep asking her, Marilyn, what color is that white chip? She has a lot of trouble with that question. My sobriety date is December 20th, 1964. I've been sober through the grace of God since that time, and I'm delighted to be here, and I'm especially delighted with the turnout here every Thursday night to go through the big book with me. You know, I believe so strongly in this book and the message that it brings that every time I'm asked if I'd be willing to share the big book with a group, I just say yes, because this is where it all is. Every time I think about the big book and whether it works or not, whether we should be paying attention to this book, I think about what Dr. Bob's wrote in his story. You probably all know this, but I like to remind myself. Dr. Bob wrote in his story, which is in the back of the book, in talking about AA and the program of Alcoholics Anonymous, and especially the 12 steps, he said it never fails. If you go about with one half the zeal, you just go about getting the next drink. And you know, it all boils down to the effort that we're willing to make, doesn't it? Unfortunately, some of us are willing to make the effort, but we are not very well guided in that effort. And there are a lot of detours and side trips and an awful lot of mythology that floats around. And it's a shame, because there are people who are trying very hard to recover, and yet they're not getting the directions that are contained here in the big book. So as we study the big book together, one of the most important things we're going to be doing is finding out what these directions are and how they came about, and to begin to trust them and to rely upon them, and more importantly than that, to carry this message to others. Because that's the name of the game. The end game here for each one of us is how well we're willing to be the carriers of the message to the next person to come along. Now, last week we were working in the forward to the second edition. Tonight we're going to be commencing on page 19, that's XIX. XIX. Last week we were looking at the 12 traditions as they are laid out here. And by the way, this forward to the second edition is an extremely important 5 or 6 pages, because it is the first introduction of the newcomer to some of the history of AA. And that our history is so rich. But more important than that is the fact that there are so many things that had to happen, or you and I wouldn't even be here tonight. And as we read this forward to the second edition, we get a chance to begin to get a sense of God's guiding hand in all of this, because you know, we would have had disaster upon disaster back in those early days. Any one of those disasters could have and probably would have sidetracked this whole effort, which has culminated in us being here tonight. This fellowship being alive and well and performing its function all over the world, everywhere you go now. But as we read this, we get at least some flavor of what happened back then. And it's also interesting to note that in the 11th chapter, A Vision for You, much of the same material as we find here is again covered, and it's a little different format, and it's a little more detailed, but it has a very specific purpose. The real purpose of that 11th chapter is to convince the people who have received the book and who have recovered and who have begun to work with others to do so and to begin to form their own groups wherever they might be. And so the 11th chapter concentrates on describing for the new person how the original groups came about and how they formed, so that they too can go out and form their groups. And of course, we know just how successful that's been. We're now looking at well over 100,000 groups worldwide, probably up in the 115,000 or so, maybe more than that. And yet, when this book was written, there were three. And the group in Cleveland was really pretty new. It was just a baby group. But in Akron and New York, the seeds had been planted, and the gigantic field of redwood trees that was going to grow was nothing but a couple of seedlings. And now we look around and we say, wow, you know, we know that there are at least 5 million of us out there in the fellowship worldwide, probably 2 or 3 million of us in the United States. Nobody has a complete census, of course. It's impossible because the door keeps swinging, you know. People come and people go, and so many people do not belong to groups, or if they do, the groups, our bookkeeping is typically alcoholic. We may very well have a membership roster which includes people who slipped 4 years ago, and a whole bunch of them that are no longer in town, or even some that died, and yet nobody bothers to go back and purge the list. We just wouldn't do that. So it's pretty hard to get a complete handle on this. But we do know that as a result of what happened then, and we've been reading about it here, this fellowship has continued to grow at the rate of something around 20% a year. And it's exponential, you know. It's a geometric progression. It's like an engine that's under full head of steam and just even going downhill now. And as we read last week, these traditions are a major part of the reason that we're here at all, that the fellowship exists, because this is not an outfit that conforms to any models at all out there. Things that human beings have put together, none of them would look like the fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous, because we don't have any rules and we don't have any leaders, and we don't have anybody out there calling the shots, and there's no AA police, and there's no way to discipline anybody, and you remember when you say you are. We won't accept money from anybody. This is the only outfit I know of that doesn't in any way ever have its hand out to the federal government or the state or local governments, you know, hand us out some money, or all the big foundations. Just think what would happen if we went to Ford Foundation or the Guggenheim or any of those. I said, man, we're Alcoholics Anonymous, and we need a couple, 3 million to whatever. We got to pay Bill Wilson III, you know, our president for life. Oh, God. Can you imagine if somebody walked in here and they plopped themselves down in this chair and said, well, my name is Jim, and I was appointed by Bill Wilson III, president for life, to be the czar of South Florida. Now listen up, folks, because these are going to be the rules that you must follow, or else. How long do you think it'd be before I was being turkey walked out that door? Never to be seen again. Probably end up in Biscayne Bay, floating face down. We would not tolerate any of that. We don't have to, because what other outfit do you know, and I'm including here the churches I've been familiar with, that actually lives by the principle that all of our major decisions and our major guidance is going to come as a matter of inspiration from a loving God. It's incredible, you know. And you think, well, human beings can't live up to that. I mean, they give lip service to it, but that's not true. You know, we hold the group conscience to be our guide. And even in the times when we don't like the group conscience, we still, for the unity of the fellowship, we deal with it. And even when there's a lot of politicking going on, somehow or another, it just seems to keep working. And so we looked at the traditions and we realized that but for those traditions, we probably would not have survived. And yet, universally, the members of Alcoholics Anonymous honor these traditions. Some few are always renegades, but for the most part, 99% of us, the traditions are the way that we live our group life. we also saw, as we were talking last week, these traditions are principles, and they apply to us as individuals just as much as they do to the groups. We need to study them and to understand that there's a direct application for us in our individual lives as well as in our group life. Now we're going to start at the bottom of page 19, XIX, the last sentence down there. And we're going to learn a little bit more about the fellowship and what happened. While the internal difficulties of our adolescent period were being ironed out, public acceptance of AA grew by leaps and bounds. For there were two principal reasons: the large number of recoveries and the reunited homes. These made their impression everywhere. Of alcoholics who came to AA and really tried, underline that, really tried, because that's the key here, who came to AA and really tried, 50% got sober at once and remained that way, 25% sobered up after some relapses, and among the remainder, those who stayed on with AA showed improvement. Now those numbers don't seem to comport with what we see around here these days, and perhaps we should think a little bit about them and ask ourselves why. Why is it that that the people who come in here and who really try, 50% stick and never drink again? And that doesn't happen. Maybe it does. I don't know who's counting, but it doesn't seem that way. And then the ones that slip 25% come back and they end up in the fellowship and staying sober, and then the other 25%, some show up and some don't. Well, I think these are probably horseback numbers, not intended to be precise or that accurate, but to me it carries a kind of a story that at the time that this was being written, AA was different in many respects than it is today, and I know that from my own experience, because it was quite different when I came in. I'll give you a couple of examples. There was no 90 and 90. The rule was 9 steps in 90 days or less. And the rule also was 15 and 30, 15,000 meetings in 30 years, and then you can back off a little bit if you feel like it. Nobody sat around and waited to be sponsored. Because you see, the tradition, the sponsorship tradition as it started out, is reported in the grapevine about 1944, 45, somewhere in there, was that the group would designate a member to be the sponsor of the new person. And their original duties were to help them just to get oriented and if they needed hospitalization, help them with that and introduce them to the group, begin the introduction to the big book and the steps. And so this was pretty much the way it was. I remember when I came in, this was 1964, two guys came up to me after the meeting and said, "We're your sponsors." And they handed me a book with a bunch of names and phone numbers. And they were right. They were my sponsors, and they continued to be my sponsors until both of them had died. And but I had no idea what was going on. But today we just cavalierly say, "Well, read the big book, come to meetings and get a sponsor." Well, what in the hell's a sponsor? And how do I pick one? And how do I know who would be a good sponsor and who wouldn't? Well, one answer to that is you might just kind of wait for God to shove you in the right direction, and maybe that works. But so much of the time, people are floating around here sometimes for years with no sponsor and no steps, hanging on by their fingernails, wondering why they feel so terrible, trying to stay sober with untreated alcoholism because there's nobody helping them. We might want to think about that. I believe, it's my own personal opinion, the biggest problem in AA today is lack of good sponsorship. And there's so much diversity now of opinion as to how you work the steps, and there's all kinds of stuff floating around out there like this thing. Which doesn't have anything to do with the big book, by the way. I mean, just somebody's idea, I guess, of a sixth step. I don't know. When we read the book, we find the instructions are right there. I'd like to see a whole bunch of people just open the book up and be a sponsor and follow directions in the book and teach the directions in the book and see what happens. We're going to get recovery after recovery. This is the way it's always been, and it would be that way again today. And so when we look at these numbers, they might give us pause. We may want to stop and think, what's going on here? And we cannot, as Bill said in one of his articles in the Grapevine, we cannot content ourselves, he said, with believing that people are not getting it. They're leaving because they didn't really want it, or because they never got past their self-will, or they never really worked the first step. We got every damn excuse in the world why people walk out the door and never be seen again. Sometimes I think we ought to look at ourselves and say, what am I not doing to help that new person? Next time you see some real bummy looking guy come sluicing in that door, maybe crawling on his hands and knees, watch and see how many people go up and give him a hug. And we have to ask ourselves, I think, why? Why is that guy not the center of the attention? Isn't his spirit as important as mine? Of course it is. Do I believe that God got me in here? Most of us do. Then why don't we believe that God shoved that guy in the door? Sometimes it's just too much work, or we don't know what we're going to be doing with him, or we're afraid. Alcoholics Anonymous is built upon one alcoholic working with another. It's built upon the love that we show for our brothers and sister alcoholics, and it's built upon working and self-sacrificing for other people. Not only is the fellowship built upon that, but our personal recovery depends upon it. Now let's go on and see what else we've got here. Other thousands came to a few AA meetings and at first decided they didn't want the program. But great numbers of these, about 2 out of 3, began to return as time passed. And we love to see that. You know, these days, it's like, how many people do you see who are picking up a white chip who this is maybe their 15th time or their 20th time? And we like to tell ourselves, well, they just didn't want it badly enough, or they weren't ready. Maybe, maybe not. What kind of support did they get? What kind of sponsorship was offered to them? Who was it that sat down with them and thoroughly explained the program to them to show them what it was that needed to be done? Who shared with them what they had gone through and how they recovered? How many of these people ever had someone sit down and tell them about the disease of alcoholism and what it means and how devastating it is? We have to ask ourselves these, because everything that comes down, everybody that comes in that door is a personal responsibility of everybody in this room to help, if we can. We're going to offer that help. Going on now on page 20, XX, middle of the page. Another reason for the wide acceptance of AA was the ministration of friends. Friends in medicine, religion, and the press, together with innumerable others who became our able and persistent advocates. Without such support, AA could have made only the slowest progress. And this is true, you know, in those days, I guess a lot of it had to do with the fact that AA was it was new and it was something that caught everybody's imagination. Well, these days, almost everybody knows that there's an AA out there. And every judge is sitting up there deciding to sentence people to us. And all, you know, it's, so AA is not something unique anymore in the eyes of the public, but in those days it was. And a lot of people wanted to jump on the bandwagon because they could see the results. There were recoveries that were appearing all over the place as a result of this program. And people in the religious community, this is not by any means universally so, but many did come to believe that we had something here. Just a couple of days ago, I met with the minister of the Baptist Church in Isla Morada down the Keys, and he's been struggling down there to help the people in his church. And as you probably know, the Keys are just loaded with drunks and addicts. I mean, they're just every place you look. And there isn't really much going on down there in way of help for them except AA. And this guy was beside himself because they were supposed to be able to get sober following the precepts of the religion. And yet they weren't. And so we sat and talked for a while, and he's been coming to a meeting I do down there on the steps. And I had written the 12 Steps for Christians some years ago. So I gave him a copy of that, and I told him how to go about doing that. We get the people into your office and sit them down and show them how to work these steps. Because what happens there is that the same great spiritual principles which are found in every religion are restated in the 12 steps as steps of action. So that what happens is that when we work the steps, we actually incorporate these great spiritual principles into our very being. They become a part of us. They become the way we live our lives. And so it's taking the spiritual program of the church and putting it into the everyday active life of the member of the church who happens to be a drunk or an addict. And they recover. So he's busily out there right now trying to get some of his people going with the steps, and I promised I'd help him with that if he needed help. But to me, this is a constant illustration that something more is needed for recovery from alcoholism, because alcoholism is the symptom of this underlying disease, which basically centers on self. Selfishness, self-centeredness. And when we are buried in self, we exclude God. And it doesn't seem to matter how much we want Him, or how often we confess our sins, or how often we go to the altar, or whatever it is that the particular rigid religion requires of us. Somehow or another, when our lives are based upon self, and we are making decisions based on self, and we're acting on those decisions, we exclude God. As the big book says, we are blocked from the sunlight of the Spirit. And yet when we work the steps, we're doing exactly what the great religionists would have us do. We're putting the principles into action, and we are making them a part of our lives, and we're making them the way we live our lives. And all of a sudden, by doing this, we've opened up all of the blockage between us and God comes flooding in. And we know from our tenth step, right after our tenth step, that we do then enter the world of the Spirit. Something major happens. And we're restored to sanity. And we become God conscious. And we develop a vital sixth sense, the big book calls it, which means that we have a direct connection with God. We are able to be inspired. We're able to be intuitively guided. And then we have a spiritual awakening. And all of this takes place automatically. It takes place because we work the steps. We follow the directions and work the steps. And in all of this, what we are doing is we are preparing ourselves to be of maximum service to God and the people about us. That's the ultimate goal here. Everybody would have you think the ultimate goal is sobriety. No. The ultimate goal is to fit ourselves to be of maximum service to God and the people about us. If we have done that, we will not drink. we will have sobriety in the very best sense of that term. Because what we have is sobriety based upon spiritual growth, spiritual awareness, spiritual awakening, spiritual obedience, you see. So when we concentrate on not drinking, we miss the whole point. And unfortunately, there's so many people now these days who want to try to tell us that the only thing that's necessary is not to drink, and that if we don't drink, our whole life will change. That's a bunch of nonsense. Of course, if we're not drinking, we're not going to be stumbling into all those horrible things we did before. But it doesn't mean anything has changed up here or in our hearts. All it means is that we're not foolishly stumbling into all of these scrapes we were getting in before. But the big book doesn't say don't drink, never tells us that. It says find God. Find and surrender to God, become obedient to His will, carry His message, be of maximum service to Him and the people about you, and you will have the perfect armor and you will not drink again. But far more important than that, you will continue to grow spiritually and you'll have a life which is characterized by happiness, joyousness, and freedom. That's our heritage. That's what we're working for. And primarily to be free from the bondage of self. Self cancels God. We cannot expect to be God conscious and to have a successful bondage with God so long as we are bound up in self. So long as our spirit is tied down in a psychic fetal position by the ropes and chains of self, it isn't going to happen. And that's what this program does. It sets us free of all of that and changes our lives completely. We need to teach that to the new people when they come in. Why are they here? What's going on here? And when we don't do that, I think we drop the ball entirely in our responsibilities. Going on now on page 20, XX, Alcoholics Anonymous is not a religious organization. Neither does AA take any particular medical point of view, though we cooperate widely with the men of medicine as well as the men of religion. If we are not a religious organization, then we must not deal or dabble in religious concepts. Things which are unique to religion or to particular religions. For example, AA does not deal with sin. Now there are a lot of people in AA who do, and that's fine because that's their religious belief, and that's fine. We have no problem with that. But we don't make moral judgments here. We leave those up to God. When we talk about confessing something, we're talking about admitting to ourselves, to God, and other human beings, the exact nature of our defects of character. Our natural God-given instincts warped and perverted by fear. We're going to admit our selfishness and self-centeredness and self-centered pride and self-delusion. We're going to admit our resentments and our angers and our rages. We're going to admit our dishonesties, especially dishonesty to self. And we're going to admit our fears, the four cardinal defects, resentment, dishonesty, selfishness, and fear. We find them in the fourth step, we find them again in the tenth step, we find them again in the 11th step, those four. Those four defects over which we have no power. We can no more be freed from them than we can be freed from alcohol on our own. We're as powerless over those defects as we are over alcohol. But we don't deal here with sin regardless of what we may read in other AA publications. And the moment that we begin to talk to somebody new and we say, well, we're not a religion, but you're going to have to watch out for deadly sins. Also, we do not have any standardized AA prayers, 11-step or otherwise, which come from somebody's saint. Now, those are wonderful prayers. And anybody here on their own certainly would want to use them, I suppose. And that's great. But they're not AA. And they can't be AA, What do we say to the Muslim who comes in here, or the Buddhist, or to the Jew? We say to them, the 11 step prayer is the prayer of a Catholic saint, and that's the standard prayer of the 11 step, and you've got to use it. And in the next breath, we tell them, but we're not a religion. And we don't espouse any particular religion. I'm suggesting that we might want to consider being consistent in what we're saying and believing and what we teach to the people who come in the door, or even among ourselves. But we are not a religion. However, it is amazing how many of us do belong to various religious organizations. And you know, one of the things that I've noticed is that the people who have embraced AA and the religious principle, the spiritual principles of AA, make wonderful church members. They really do. They're so welcome, because you know, we're steeped in spiritual values every day. We don't wait around for Sunday or Saturday to get religious or spiritual. And so we can be very, very fine members of a religious organization, and many of us are. But that's not AA. And there are lots of people who are sitting in this room right now who don't ever go to church, don't intend to ever go to church, and nobody's saying anything to them. Well, you're out to lunch, you don't go to church. No. Because we don't espouse any particular religious beliefs, and we could not. Alcoholism spreads across every section of humanity, every country, every section of every country. I remember being in Russia in 1988, this was before the wall came down and before AA had arrived there, and seeing what was going on. Russia was so plagued with alcoholism and alcoholics at that time, it was a veritable plague. And by the way, AA had found itself there, even though the mentioning of God was something that was anathema to communists. Of course, they could rat you out because you were talking about God or higher power. They didn't have the big book in Russian, but they had it in French and in German. And they were meeting already. Now, of course, now the big book's in Russian, and we've got a ton of brothers and sisters in Russia right now who are in recovery. Thank you, God, for that. We were late getting there. Now, going on, alcohol being no respecter of persons, we are an accurate cross-section of America, and in distant lands, the same democratic evening up process is now going on. By personal religious affiliation, we include Catholics, Protestants, Jews, Hindus, and a sprinkling of Muslims and Buddhists. This is funny. More than 15% of us are women. Of course, we know that when this was written, that was quite a while ago. This was written in 1955. And remember that the fellowship had been around quite a while before the first women ever got sober in AA. The big book had been written in draft form by Bill Wilson when Marty Mann became the first woman member. I think we mentioned this a few weeks ago. Does anybody wonder how Marty Mann got sober? She was the only woman. She couldn't have a sponsor, right? Oh, okay. Maybe that's not right. I don't know. She did get sober, God bless her. In fact, she helped a whole lot of guys get sober. She was the only woman around. She had the woman's touch. She was great. She was a great sponsor. Okay, at present our membership is pyramiding at the rate of about 20% a year. So far, upon the real problems of several million actual potential alcoholics in this world, we have made only a scratch. In all probability, we shall never be able to touch more than a fair fraction of the alcohol problem in all of its ramifications. Upon therapy for the alcoholic himself, we surely have no monopoly, yet it is our great hope that all those who have as yet found no answer may begin to find one in the pages of this book and will presently join us on the high road to a new freedom. And when they wrote this book, that was exactly what they had in mind, wasn't it? They wanted this book to go out and be available to alcoholics everywhere. And nobody knows for sure how many alcoholics are out there in the United States or worldwide, but it's way, way up in the many, 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 multiple millions, no doubt about it. Some people have estimated that something on the magnitude of 5 or 6% of the total world population is alcoholic. There are some areas where we find alcoholism is rampant in the high 60s and 70%. And yet, since the statistics are very hard to come by, we don't know how high up the scale alcoholism in terms of the cause of death, and yet we suspect that it may cause more death than anything else. So many people are not shown as the cause of death being alcoholism, but heart failure or automobile crashes or all kinds of things. It is an epidemic. And when we combine this with the epidemic in drugs, my God, it's like this whole world's gone nuts. I mean, it's incredible. I was some of you know I went to prison about 4 years ago because I refused to rat out one of my sponsees, and the federal government is tough to deal with, so they threw me in prison. And supposedly until I was willing to testify, they finally had to let me go. But while I was there, I had a very unique experience. I got to be in a with a bunch of guys, all of whom almost all of them were in the drug business in one way or another, a bunch of gangbangers, I guess they call them. There were in my particular ward, there were about 40 guys, and every single one of those people, to my personal knowledge, had alcohol or drugs in his story. And some of these people were very young, and since they had been messing around with crack and selling the stuff, they were looking in the federal system, they were looking at 18 years in federal penitentiary. An absolutely incredible thing. And yet, looking around, I could see there was nobody in there who wasn't there because of or as a part of their problem was alcohol and drugs. And I had to say, wow, this stuff. But you know, we live, some of us live a kind of a sheltered existence. We really don't see what's going on. We don't know just how bad it is out there. But if you want to see how bad it is, get yourself tossed in the clink for a while. Believe me, you'll see it then. You know, I was very lucky, you know why? But I'm old enough that they called me Pops. Now, in prison, Pops is protected. You don't get hassled. And as long as you keep your head down and your mouth shut, you're just fine. And everywhere I went, they'd say, hey, Pop, what are you doing? How come you're here, Pop, you know? And then they come to you and they treat you like some kind of an elder statement or something. So it wasn't very pleasant being locked up, but at least I wasn't getting attacked or any of that horrible stuff you hear about. And that was my first time. At that time I was 70 years old and 32 years sober, and the first time I'd ever been arrested. And I told the people about that, and they said, what the hell is the point of getting sober if you're going to get arrested and thrown in jail when you're 30 years sober? Oh, man. So, but my scruples got in the way. I guess what it boiled down to is this. If I ratted Al out, I knew a lot about him from his fourth step, and he'd done some criminal stuff, no doubt about it. But if I had given in to the pressure and testified before the grand jury about that stuff, I could never sit up here in front of you guys ever again. Because whatever credibility I might have would have been gone. I could never say again, you know, you can trust me. And so I wasn't going to throw my life away that way. And in the meantime, it was interesting. A friend of mine sent me a softcover big book. And I'd been there about two months, I guess, about that time. But I got the thing in the mail. I went out in a sort of like a day area we had, and I was reading it. Somebody came over and asked me what it was. I said, "Oh, this is the Alcoholics Anonymous big book." "Oh, yeah?" Within 2 days, we had a meeting going. Every day, five or six guys would show up. Some of them were just kicking tires, you know. They didn't have anything better to do. There wasn't anything on television at that moment. But it began to sink in. And two of those guys I still write to and I hear from, and they're staying sober, and they're in recovery. They're still in prison, but they're in recovery. So I said, "Okay, thank you, God. That was what was supposed to happen here." Because this particular prison didn't allow AA to come in. They said, "All right, we tried those people about 10 years ago, and that didn't work out." Later, I found out, after I got out of there, I went back to this town where the prison was, and I started talking to people in AA, and they said, "We don't go over to that place. They ask us to come. We don't go." "So why not?" "Oh, well, you know, nobody over there wants to hear anything about recovery anyway." I said, "Well, you guys are kind of lazy, aren't you? You know, you haven't figured out what you're supposed to be doing yet?" I was not popular. I got run out of town on a rail. What do you expect in North Florida? You know, it's real close to the Alabama border. So. Anyway, what we're going to do, guys, is we're going to skip the third and fourth edition forwards. Read them if you like, but we've gotten the meat of everything out of the first two forwards. So now, if you'll open your book up to page 25 or 23, depending if it's the third edition, it'll be on page 23. That's XXIII, or the fourth edition is XXV. And we're going to start with our study of the doctor's opinion. Before we get into that, though, let's remind ourselves of who this guy is. Because, first of all, what we read here in this book is an incredible thing. This Dr. Silkworth was, of course, he was a highly world-renowned guy. He was the director of Towns Hospital, and people came from all over the world to get straightened out from alcohol and drugs at Towns Hospital, and he was supposed to be an authority, and he had a huge reputation in the profession. So when Dr. Silkworth wrote about something, people were going to listen. As a matter of fact, that later, when the American Medical Association decided that alcoholism was in fact a disease, Dr. Silkworth was called upon to write out the protocols. But in 1939, when he wrote his opinion, he was out there in a left field. I mean, he was dangling slowly in the wind because there wasn't anybody around in the medical profession who was even willing to think that he might be right. I tell you this: when Dr. Silkworth called alcoholism a disease, he was not the first. The first guy to do that was a doctor in France, and that was in the 1800s, I think around 1870. And I don't remember the guy's name, but he wrote an article which was published in one of the French medical journals, stating that in his opinion, that alcoholism was a form of disease. It was the disease syndrome. Now, he didn't identify it as a type of allergy or anything that Dr. Silkworth did, but he just gave us his opinion and backed it up with some of his experience and his treatment, that alcoholics were the victims of a disease. Well, don't you know that this guy was laughed at, and they blasted him, and they were all these other doctors chimed in, and there were articles written the next year saying just how far off base he was, and this guy kind of disappeared from the scene. He never mentioned that again. So when Dr. Silsworth was called upon by the boys when they were writing this book to put his medical opinion into written form, that's going to be published in a book which they expected to have wide circulation, Dr. Silsworth had to have a whole ton of guts to do that, and also the courage of his convictions. Let's not forget that. Now, this was a guy who they called the little doctor, but they thought of him as a medical saint. Now, the truth of the matter is that Dr. Silsworth should have had the Nobel Prize in Medicine for 1939, because what he wrote has since been adopted by medical societies all over the world. The American Medical Association adopted Dr. Silsworth's theory in whole cloth, in 1947. Said, yes, alcoholism is a disease. Opened up all the doors for insurance help and for the government to help. And today, so many of us have been blessed with that. And of course, that also started a series of different governmental interventions and ending up with something called the National Council on Alcoholism. National Council on Alcoholism was appointed by the president in 1970, I think it was. They began to have telethons, and they were really going out after alcoholics. They were going to get us all cured and cleaned up, you know. And places like the Rand Institute out in Santa Monica, a big, big, highly respected think tank, they came out with stuff like, we have found how to keep an alcoholic from drinking excessively. We have found out how to make a social drinker out of an alcoholic. And the Rand Institute was behind all of this. And it was a front page article in the LA Times. 3 years later, their tails between their legs, they have to admit that we alcoholics had them beat. Now, the retraction of all of this ballyhoo was printed on page 17, buried in the inner column where you couldn't see it, with a tiny, tiny headline. It didn't say Rand Institute has had to eat its words or anything like that. A little squib about how they may have been a little bit premature. It's just like the pharmaceutical outfit that came out with antabuse. This was going to solve the whole problem. Just take an antabuse pill every day and you won't drink, because if you drink, it's going to make you sick. What they didn't understand was an alcoholic will take it and get sick and the hell with it. Because, you know, we just tough nuts. And the truth of the matter is, obviously now, I mean, after all these years, we know this is true. There's no human solution. There's no chemical solution. There's no psychiatric solution. There's no religious solution. There's a spiritual solution. And as soon as we get God between us and booze, we quit drinking. And until we do, we keep drinking. And until we start seeking God, as we're told to do in the third pertinent idea, we continue to have the obsession compulsion to drink. And as soon as we start seeking God, God takes it away. We say, wow, I must be pretty smart. See, I told you so. Sooner or later, we have to come to recognize the source of our recovery, and it's always going to be our higher power. This whole book says so. This whole book is based upon it, and Dr. Silsworth's opinion comes to the same conclusion. I'm going to give you a little preview. The last word in Dr. Silsworth's opinion is pray. The last word is pray. But next week, we're going to begin our study of his opinion and see how it ties in with our personal experience, and see how it will help us to be helpful to others, to let them see what their trouble is, and let them see what they need to do in order to recover as we have recovered. I want to thank all of you so much for letting me share this with you, and I plan to be back here next week, God willing, the creek don't rise. Oh, by the way, I think, maybe somebody can enlighten me on that. I was asked to tell my story next week or something, is that right? Anybody have objection to that?
Next Thursday? Great.
All right, so next week we won't be doing the doctor's opinion, except I'll tell you a little bit about my story, but I'll tell you my story next week.
Great. We're very blessed that Jim has come over and is sharing the series with us. Could I please have a volunteer to do the chips?
Eric, come on, Chris.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is...
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Bottom Line Group of Alcoholics Anonymous. This is a closed meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous. We ask that you silence your cell phones and pagers at this time, and please refrain from cursing when you share. Could I please have three volunteers to help clean up after the meeting? Thank you. In support of AA's singleness of purpose, attendance at closed meetings is limited to persons who have a desire to stop drinking. If you think you have a problem with alcohol, you are welcome to attend this meeting. We ask that when discussing our problems, we confine ourselves to those problems as they relate to alcoholism. Please join me in a moment of silence followed by the Serenity Prayer. God,
grant me serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference.
Amen.
Is there anyone here for their first meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous? Okay. Anyone visiting from another group that would like to introduce themselves? Hi.
Hi, I'm an alcoholic. My name is Kim.
Hi, Kim. Welcome. Is there anyone here that's returning after research? Okay. Our preamble, Alcoholics Anonymous is a fellowship of men and women who share their experience, strength, and hope with each other that they may solve their common problem and help others to recover from alcoholism. The only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. There are no dues or fees for AA membership. We are self-supporting through our own contributions. AA is not allied with any sect, denomination, politics, organization, or institution. Does not wish to engage in any controversy, neither endorses nor opposes any causes. Our primary purpose is to stay sober and help other alcoholics to achieve sobriety. And Tom has offered to read how it works.
My name's Tom, I'm an alcoholic.
Hi, Tom.
Rarely we see a person fail who has thoroughly fought or passed. Those who do not recover, people cannot or will not completely give themselves this simple program. Usually men and women who are constitutionally incapable of being honest with themselves. There are such unfortunates and not at fault that seem to be born that way. They are naturally incapable of rapidly developing a manner of living which demands their honesty. Their chances are less than average. There are those too who suffer from grave emotional and mental disorders, but many of them do recover if they have the capacity to be honest. Our stories disclose in a general way what we used to be like, what happened, and what we're like now. If you have decided you want what we have and are willing to go any length to get it, then you're ready to take certain steps. And some of these we fought. We thought we'd find an easier, softer way, but we could not. With all the earnestness of our command, we beg of you to be fearless and thorough from the very start. Some of us have tried to hold on to old ideas, and the result was nil until we let go absolutely. Remember that we do it alcohol, cunning, baffling, and powerful. Without help, it's too much for us. There is one who has all power, and one is God. May you find him now. Half the measure of the bill is nothing. We stood at the turning point. We asked for protection, care, and complete abandon. Here are the steps we took, which are suggested as a program recovery. When we admitted we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives had become unmanageable. Two, came to believe in a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Three, made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understood him. Four, made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. justified in admitting to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrong. 6, we're entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. 7, fully ask to remove our shortcomings. 8, may this bald person be harmed and became willing to make amends to man. 9, may direct amends to such people wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. 10, continue to take personal inventory, and when we were wrong, promptly amend it. 11, sought through prayer meditation to improve our conscious contact with God as we understood Him, praying only for the knowledge of His will for us and the power to carry that out. Step 12, having had a spiritual awakening as was already stated, we tried to carry this message to alcoholics and to practice these principles in all our affairs. Many of us exclaim, what an order, I can't go through with it. Do not be discouraged. No one among us has been able to maintain anything like perfect adherence to these principles. We're not saints. The point is that we want to go along spiritual lines. The principles we have set down are guides to progress. We claim spiritual progress rather than spiritual perfection. Our description of the alcoholic, the chapter of the agnostic, and our personal adventures before and after make clear 3 pertinent ideas. A, that we were alcoholic and could not manage our own lives. B, that probably no human power could ever leave our alcoholism. And C, that God could
avoid it. Thank you. I'm going to do the secretary's report now because so we don't have to interrupt the meeting later.
This is the 7th tradition, the bastards going around, and we are self-supporting. The planning is outside my community, and not my office. There's 5 meetings a week, and they are listed on the green chalkboard.
You need 2 years of sobriety to chair a Big Book Supper Tradition meeting, 1 year to chair an 8:30 p.m. or beginner's meeting, and 6 months to chair a regular meeting. Anniversary night is held the last Sunday of the month at 7 p.m. If you are celebrating a year or more, add your name to the anniversary board and we will gladly celebrate with you. Business meetings are held the first Sunday of the month at 6:45 p.m. If you would like to be a member of the Bottom Line group, sign your name in the black book on the desk here. You must be a member to vote on any motions or group conscience. A weekly cleaning party is held every Saturday at 1 p.m. This is a rewarding opportunity for service. Please come out. There are AA and non-AA related bulletin boards around the room for your information. Literature and grapevines on the rack are for sale at cost. Please pay the chairperson. Please keep the grounds clean and remember to park between the white lines, not in the gravel or designated no parking areas. There is a temporary sponsor list on the back wall. Take a name off if you need a sponsor and put your name on it if you are willing to be a sponsor. Would all those willing to be a temporary sponsor please raise your hands? Okay, thank you. The Bottom Line group conscience. Are there any announcements for the good of AA? No. Okay, great. Now we can actually get on with what we're here for. I'm just so thrilled that Jim B. is here doing the Big Book series. His home group is the 101 and Stairway?
Stairway
to Heaven. Anyway, let's welcome Jim.
Basically, first we want to do is okay. In 2 weeks, I'm going to go basically work it. But I mean, I'll fit it every night. I'll read it. So, first thing we want to do is read the book. Yeah. Thanks, Jim.
Sir? Where's that gavel? I just love that thing.
You can.
Oh, he's chairing.
You can use that. Bruce called, will not be here for the 10 p.m. meeting. All right.
Let it go.
sit here and trust in you that my home is not burning right now. And every time I close it, someone gives me a dollar, and someone else sees me, and I haven't left.
There you go.
And don't be scared. Thank you. I'm okay.
I was going to be a psychologist at one point.
And what happened?
I applied to the University of Miami, and I had to take a statistic. I didn't have statistics in my resume. Got a client to the University of Miami, and this guy said, "Oh, you're the doctor." Wax a car. I wax cars.
You wax cars?
I look for my okay.
I'm going to let the take over. You got to let it take over.
Right.
If you stop trying to make things work.
No, but my brain tells me stuff.
Every time you're told it, it's full of a lie.
Why?
You say, Jim?
Everything's good.
What are we doing tonight? What part of the book?
We're going to finish up the forward of the second.
Well, it's his opinion.
That's good.
I thought that was really good.
Well, Yale wanted to make him
a doctor.
LLD.
Right.
Budweiser wanted to hire him as a
consultant.
Right.
So he did take the one award, which was good.
Well, that, yeah.
That's pretty prestigious.
He should have been the man of the century.
I don't know. My sponsor talks to me about him all the time. He says different stuff about him that sometimes. To divert a second, I read an article in the paper today. The New York Post, it was fashionable to be in recovery 4 years ago. But this guy was talking, he says, trend-wise, it's not really cool to do a recovery anymore. It's not like the in thing like it was. Like things go through in vogue and everything. Like a couple of years ago, if you were like a lawyer and you dropped the name that you were in recovery or something, that was like you were the bomb.
Yep.
But now it's like more like it was in a way. Not that that's good or bad, but just saying, like with Bill Wilson, that's like it keeps going. No matter what in vogue is, he just keeps going.
But he was very, very human.
Right? I think so. I know about his depression and different things. He thought he had no percentage of COVID. He don't look like
an apocryphal story.
All right, yeah. I'm going to get some coffee. Let's go there.
Okay.
Thank you.
But you've got a big smile on your face about it.
Oh, no, I'm just glad. I'm glad. Oh.